I'm Rick Green with The Oklahoman. I cover the state capitol for The Oklahoman and News OK. And I'm here today with Pam Pollard, chairman of the Oklahoma Republican Party. Pam, welcome.
Well, glad to be here. Thank you for the invitation, Rick.
Sure. Here we are in an election year, and you have a very important position with the state party. Tell us a little bit about your goals and what you hope to achieve as chairman.
Well, thank you. That's a great question. What do we hope to achieve? Victory in November. Victory in the White House, as well as victory in maintaining our large majority here in our state. This year is unique with term limits that started in 2004. This is the first election cycle where the term limits have created open seats. This year we have 32 open House and Senate seats specifically due to term limits. So we have a lot of work to do, and I'm up for the challenge. Mm-hmm.
Now tell us a little bit about your background. Where are you from originally, and what's your educational and professional background?
Well, I was born and raised in Florida. My father was in the Air Force, so I spent kindergarten and first grade in Aviano, Italy. So I was love to travel. I love to think outside the box and see new horizons on things. And we came back to Florida when I was in elementary school and graduated from Popka High School in a small town outside of Orlando. And I was actually the first female athlete in my high school to be given a full scholarship at a university, and I played softball in Florida. So I was the pitcher of the softball team. And because of that, I actually got a degree in forestry. And the United States Forest Service hired me to come from Orlando, Florida to Ida Bell, Oklahoma in 1980. So that's how I got to Oklahoma, and I met my husband, and we've had a family here. And later I went back to school and changed degrees and graduated from East Central University with a degree in accounting. And I have been a practicing accountant since 1986.
So you have a degree in forestry and a degree in accounting?
I do.
Are you a CPA?
No, I'm not a CPA. I chose not to go that route. I was busy at home with children and at the time grandchildren as well. So I chose not to go that way and specialize in just business. And I like to do business consulting. Mm-hmm. I also used to build computers. Mm-hmm. And I would go to businesses and went especially at startup businesses, help them build their computer, their accounting system. And I was a one-stop shop from the beginning of their business all the way through their tax returns. So,
and how did you get into the political end of things?
A state representative, Forrest Clunch, knocked on my door one day campaigning. And I was a stay-at-home mom, and we were taking care of some of the kids that day. And I'll never forget, he was just standing at my doorstep, he and his wife, and we were just talking about life and issues. And he invited me to get involved. He said, Pam, you have some opinions that I think are important. And when he asked me that, I said to myself, I'm not any different from anyone else. But he said, your voice is important, and invited me to come to a Republican meeting. Mm-hmm. And I went, and that was the beginning of my activism. And mainly, Rick, one thing that the reason I got involved was exactly what your business does here. I got involved because I needed to find more information, but I also saw the opportunity to learn more information and share more information, because people just often don't know what is going on. Mm-hmm. So I was very involved in it, and very fortunate that I was given that opportunity early on in my political career to be so involved with someone that was as great of a man as Forrest Clunch.
And what positions have you held in the political arena?
Well, I have, right after I got involved, I was appointed as the state credentials chairman for the state Republican women. And I say that because as a state credentials chairman, your job is to know the rules and to be the enforcer and the leader of the rules. So because I got my first start going the rules path, then I was very soon elected as Oklahoma County chairman. I served two terms as Oklahoma County chairman. I have also been elected as the state Republican Party vice chairman. Now I'm the state chairman with the Republican women. I have served as a local club president. I've served as their state treasurer, but I've also served as the state president. In October of last year, I was elected as the treasurer of the National Federation of Republican Women. But I have since resigned that position, active on January 1st of this year.
And the previous chairman of the state Republican Party, was that Randy Brogdon?
Yes, sir. The chairman right before me was Randy Brogdon.
And he ended up resigning from that position, is that right?
He did.
And there was a fair amount of controversy during his tenure. As I recall, one of his staff members had a background that kind of served as a lightning rod for criticism. And when you came in, was there a effort to say, we're an inclusive group here, we want to bring all people under the big Republican umbrella?
Absolutely. That has been one thing that I've tried to do my entire political career. As I said, the reason I got involved is because I wanted to learn more about the issue so I could make an informed decision and get involved with the people who were making laws that affected my life. So from the very beginning, I have had that mindset that everyone needs to get involved. It's not up to me as a party leader to determine which group gets involved. Mm-hmm. We want to invite everyone to have a voice because I truly believe that's what America was built on. My mother's an Irish immigrant. My mother was born and raised in Ireland. So immigration and people in foreign countries coming in and bringing in their points of views is something that I experienced within my own family in traveling back to Ireland and talking with my family. So I see that unique perspective of many people's ideas, and when I look at that, I see that that's what made America great. Most of the inventions in America was because of all of the immigrants that have come here. So I want to help empower ideas within the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm. And does that also apply to women's issues?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It applies to every issue, Rick. It really does. As a woman, yes, there's parts of my life that I do focus on women's issues, especially when it involves my family members, our daughters. But just as importantly, it's a lot of the teachings we have with the young men in my life and in our Sunday school class. So I think teaching, just making people aware of the present day, some of the things that is going on in the present day world, whether it be how people are treating females or, just as importantly, how some of the males are feeling as well. Mm-hmm.
Well, you talked about bringing diverse groups in under the Republican umbrella. You talk about minorities and you talk about women and all groups. Is that a struggle? Because on the national Republican front, there's such discussion about building a big wall to keep out immigrants, of refusing to allow Muslims into the country. How do you balance the national Republican issues that are coming out in the presidential campaign with your hopes for the state party?
Well, it's very easy to me, and it's very clear to me, and I understand it may not be quite as clear to other people, but the national discussion is not whether we allow immigration. It's whether we have, if we stop illegal immigration. And I believe that's what the discussion is. When you talk with people, again, within my family, within other communities, minority communities in Oklahoma, they believe very strongly in legal immigration. And at some point, all of us are saying we must stop the illegal immigration. And another side of that in the day and time that we live in is not just that we want to stop the illegal immigration, which we do, but it's the security of our borders. And that is one strong thing. I think that's what some of the presidential candidates are talking about when they talk about building some of the walls. It's not necessarily to stop anyone from coming to our country and bringing new people in, but it's to protect our borders. And one of these days, we can only hope and pray that it will never happen, but there could be people who come in because they're able to walk across the border that might do drastic harm to our society. That's what we're trying to prevent against.
But how do minority groups respond to the kind of rhetoric, for example, that Donald Trump has put out about immigrants who've come across the border being rapists and criminals? That hasn't gone over well in the Hispanic community. How do you convince them that the Republican Party is for them?
Well, when you say it's not gone over well in the Hispanic community, first of all, we never want to try to stereotype one sector of society based on a few, the actions of a few. It doesn't matter what your background, your ethnicity is, we should never stereotype. Mm-hmm. And I think each one of us have probably in our life been a victim of someone stereotyping us in one way. So that's not the discussion. And I do not support stereotyping in any way, shape, or form. However, when you talk to people in the, let's say, the Hispanic Latino community, they do agree that there are people that the governments in other countries are sending over. If we remember, the Freedom Flotilla. I was living in Florida, raised in Florida, but was living in Arkansas at the time, and it was a known fact that when they allowed the refugees leaving Cuba, that they opened their prisons and they sent over their criminals. I think that's one of the things that we're talking about when he's talking about that. And again, we have to be very careful in how we say things, but we also have to be very careful in how we receive some of these words and take things into context.
Now, switching gears a little bit, the Republican Party dominates politics in the state at every level. But recently, a couple of Democrats won election to the state legislature. One of the big issues they've been talking about is education and the need for raises for teachers and things of that nature. Are those kinds of issues now resonating with the public, and is there a chance that the Republican Party needs to retool to address some of that?
Well, I think that education is one of the very top issues in our state today for a lot of reasons. Yes, the teacher pay is one. So many things that we could do a whole nother show and multiple shows just on the problems with education. And it is something that is very, very difficult to address because it involves people's lives. It's much easier to fix a business that has a slump in their sales. But when you're talking about children, you're talking about communities that are built around these schools, it gets extremely, extremely difficult. So our governor came out with a proposal for teacher pay raises. Whether that is going to be successful or not, I think when it did do one thing, it showed that the Republicans and our Republican legislature this year, including our governor, is looking for ways to try to get more monies in the pockets of the teachers, because they are the ones who the entire back of education is on their shoulders. So we do want to make sure that they do earn a decent wage on that. Now, what is the topic of education? What are the Republicans going to do this year? We are just getting through the first rounds of hearing these bills in their caucuses and also in the different committees. And I know there are multiple, I think dozens and dozens of education related bills. So I think we need to sit back. And one thing I would say that the Republican Party wants to do, we are trying to put out as much information as we can of when these hearings are taking place at the Capitol. We're trying to do that at least once a week, and if there's any changes, we can put it out there. But on our, not only on our website, but especially on our Facebook page, Oklahoma Republican Party, our Twitter's @OfficialOKGOP, our website is OKGOP.com, to put out the schedule of when these meetings are. And we want to allow the citizens to go to the legislature. And I was there the other day and was actually offered the opportunity as a citizen, not with the Republican Party, to speak on behalf of a piece of legislation that they were hearing. It is open to the citizens of Oklahoma. I encourage people from all around the state, come in and have a voice in your government, and let's see what we can put together for a program that will help education this year. One thing we all agree on, two things we all agree on. The first thing is something needs to be done with education, and the second, and to me most important thing, is education is not a partisan issue. It is an issue that affects every life of every citizen in the state of Oklahoma.
And yet these two Democrats who were elected recently talked about education a lot, and it seemed to help them a bit. Is the pendulum starting to swing? Is there a chance that there may be more Democratic representation in the legislature?
I don't think so. As far as the pendulum swinging, I will say that as you know, the Democrat Party opened their primaries this year for the first time in I think 60 something years to allow independents to come and vote in their primaries. The Republican Party chose to keep our primaries closed. And the reason I bring that up is because the reason we kept ours closed is that we believe that people of like mind, of that support our platform, support our statements of principle, need to be selecting our candidate. In the general election, absolutely, it's open for everybody, and you select whichever candidate you want. But I say that because the Democrat Party, since that time, to let you know where the voters are and what they are thinking, and is there a problem with Republicans in Oklahoma, it's just the opposite. One reason the Democrats did open their elections is since 1995, the Democrat Party has lost 200,000 registered voters. The Republican Party has gained 300,000, 500,000 voter swing. Since the Democrats announced that they were opening their primaries, and I don't have these exact numbers, since they opened their primaries, they had 230-something new registered voters. During that same time, the Republican Party had over 5,000 new registered voters. People identify with the message of the Republican Party, so I don't think we are going to lose great numbers of elections. But these two elections that you're talking about, I think that each one of them were unique in their own way. And the one, my good friend David Dank unexpectedly passed away, but it was very soon after, less than 6 months after his general election. And the candidate that ran against him, who was later went on to win the election, she just picked up and continued to campaign. Now, one thing I will say, when you look at her campaign, she never stated she was a Democrat. All of her campaign literature, knocking on her doors, she didn't tell people which party she identified with. So, you know, her message was a more moderate type message. And the Republicans, when we had a very large primary, and they spent a lot of time and a lot of money coming out of that primary, and then there was a very short period of time to campaign in the general election. We are going to try to make sure that our candidates have enough resources in the general election that if they have to spend a lot of their monies in the primaries, we as the Republican Party are going to try to have the resources to help them in the general election. And then the special election in Tulsa, I'll just say they had a very, very good candidate. The city, that Senate seat is formerly held by State Senator Randy Brogdon, Senator Rick Brinkley, and it was traditionally a Republican seat. But the candidate, and it's primarily the city of Owosso, the candidate that they had was born and raised in Owosso, a school teacher, dad superintendent. They were involved in the athletic programs, both their father and their mother. Very well known, great candidate. Again, ran more as a moderate, and again, did not advertise to the voters what his political party was. And our candidate, again, went through a long primary, and he lived in a town that was a very small town and was not well connected to the population center. So each one of those, I think, was unique, but each one of those, the Democrats put up a very good candidate. My job is to find good candidates on the Republican side.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming in today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. I appreciate it.